Good evening. I'm not accustomed to doing this laptop screeny thing, you know? So I hope this works out. So I think that everyone present in this room can agree that Seventh-day Adventism is a growing problem. Over 22 million members worldwide as of last June, and some other statistics to give you some context. In 2021, there were just over 1 million accessions. I assume most of you know what that means. That means new members, converts. That does not include births. Over 1 million. That averages out to one accession every 30 seconds or so. One new congregation every 3.62 hours. And at the same time, and I'm sure this will also be of interest to you, in 2021, there were almost 800,000 losses, which equals people leaving. That does not include deaths. Over the past 15 years, the rate of net losses is about 42%. Is that something to celebrate? Or, in truth, are many of these people, perhaps even most, Adventized and spiritually damaged and confused and in need of rescue themselves, even though they have walked away? Now, for me as a missionary, and Richard alluded to this, I take special note of the following numbers. In 2021, the top 20 countries in terms of Adventist membership made up nearly 75% of the world total. Three quarters in just 20 countries. 11 of those top 20 countries are in sub-Saharan Africa. And amazingly, those 11 countries, their membership makes up nearly 40% of the world total. So my real world challenge, my day-to-day challenge, as I help believers in Kenya and Uganda and Zambia and Malawi and so forth, is how can we best persuade Christians in Africa that Adventism is so biblically unsound that its false teachings need to be firmly rejected and its followers need to be evangelized? Because Adventism has a rather high reputation in these countries where it is so well established and growing at such a clip. You see, I've learned in 40-some years of going to Eastern Southern Africa, lay African Christians don't do nuance well. They just want to know, is it true or is it false? Is it a cult or isn't it? And not a lot in between is satisfying to them. Now, we have a problem because Adventism is the duckbill platypus of Christianity. It defies easy categorization. And Adventists' attitudes toward us, what do you call it? Is it schizophrenia? Is it gaslighting? You know, one minute they want to sing kumbaya with all the Protestants, and the next minute, they're the remnant church of Bible prophecy, and Sunday worship is the mark of the beast observed by Babylon and her harlot daughters. Which is it to be? Depends, doesn't it? Which brings me to a dilemma that we face sometimes, not only in Africa, but here in the United States. How do we best label this growing problem called Adventism? Because whatever label we choose, we want to be taken seriously by two distinct audiences. Outsiders, which is to say non-Adventists, in which case our objective is to warn and explain, and Adventists, in which case our objective is to evangelize. As a practical matter, for the purposes of this talk, I want to focus on persuading outsiders, that is, uninformed and frequently skeptical Christians. What label do we use? Option one, denomination. Even most Adventists seem to be just fine with this. Definitely not an inflammatory word. Option number two, new religious movement. not widely applied to the Adventists, as it seems rather improbable. 169 years old equals new, but scholars such as Irving Hexham have used it. This too is not inflammatory. It might have someone scratching their heads, but they won't get angry. Option three, sect. From the Latin secta, meaning party or school or faction. Not flattering, but also not inflammatory. Option four, the C word, cult. It's better with just a little bit of, you know, cult. Well, this word is almost always inflammatory, prompting either curiosity or outright hostility. It's a loaded word. It's best used with discretion and restraint. It can come across as mean-spirited and harsh and intended to cause injury, kind of a verbal weapon. And bear in mind that popular everyday use of the word cult is largely based on two perceptions, deviance and harm. Deviance as in, this group looks offbeat, unconventional, a little unsettling, maybe creepy. Harm. This group is capable of dangerous things, and I don't want to be there when they happen. So, just to help you imagine this a little better, in relation to using cult to describe Adventism, picture this conversation with me and a skeptical Christian. Me. Most people don't know this, but the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a cult. Skeptic. What do you mean? Like the Manson family? Like Jonestown? The Order of the Solar Temple? Branch Davidians? Shinrikyo? Nexium? Me. Well, no. I mean, they're not brainwashing their followers into killing people or committing suicide or branding their women with a hot iron. Skeptic. Oh, so like Adventists are what? Like the Mormons or the Jehovah's Witnesses? Me. Well, not exactly like them. You see, those groups are kind of authoritarian, and you can tell right away that their doctrines are really kind of weird and extreme, you know, like polytheism and special underwear and forbidding blood transfusions and voting. Skeptic. Okay, but what do you mean? A quick bit, if I can spit it out, of historical background. So none of you is probably, very few of you are probably old enough to remember these things, but 60 or so years ago, prominent evangelical authors and theologians easily applied the label cult to Seventh-day Adventism. Men like Gordon Lewis, Lewis Talbot, Anthony Hokima, Jan Carl van Balen, Harold Lindzel, Donald Gray Barnhouse, once upon a time. But prominent evangelical authors and theologians today are often unwilling to use the cult label, and these include James Beverly, who stated in his massive book on new religions that Seventh-day Adventism is in essential agreement with evangelical Christianity. Wayne House, Edmund Gruss, Ruth Tucker, who noted cultic characteristics of Adventism in her book, Another Gospel. Good for you. Norman Geisler and Ron Rhodes, who describe Adventism as aberrant in their book, When Cultists Ask. Walter Martin, who called Seventh-day Adventism a puzzle in Kingdom of the Cults. Look, Walter Martin is the elephant in this room, for this talk at least. Yes, I did work with him. I worked under him for 9 years. I was with him in the United States, in Kenya, and Brazil. So, you know, we need to be careful about presuming what persons long dead would do or say if they were alive today. But and people take that liberty with Walter Martin often. It's kind of annoying But Walter Martin was the giant speed bump for the word cult being applied to Adventism, because I almost brought my copy to wave it around. He said that, you know, Seventh-day Adventism was not to be regarded as a cult because he believed what those Adventists told him. And for many people, Kingdom of the Cults, this fat book that's in now, what, its 1,000,000th printing, is seen by people as the final word. Walter Martin was the guy who knew. This is the book. We can, I don't know more than Walter Martin, so the matter is settled, right? Now, to his credit, Walter Martin's protege, Ken Samples of Reasons to Believe, writing in the Christian Research Journal, I encourage you to read everything that Ken writes about Adventism, but he said these three things, which I quite appreciate. Quote, it would appear that traditional Adventism is at least aberrant. Quote, traditional Adventism is theologically bankrupt. And, quote, if the traditional camp continues in its departure from questions on doctrine and in promoting Ellen White as the church's infallible interpreter, then they could, one day, be fully deserving of the title cult, as some Adventists recognize. So, that by way of background. Now, in my experience, dealing with a lot of people, I'll be very interested to know what Jim says. Evangelicals do tend to just compare Adventism with the big two cults, the 19th century American cults, Mormonism and Jehovah's Witnesses. But you've probably noticed that Adventists appear less exclusionary and cult-like for a variety of reasons, including ecumenical outreach. They're not so openly strident in denouncing other churches. Thousands of schools, which, by the way, non-Adventists can attend. Hospitals and clinics around the world, which non-Adventists can benefit from. Not to mention international relief work, thinking here of ADRA, and seemingly greater tolerance for internal dissent than these other two groups. And in all five categories, Adventism compares favorably with the Mormon Church, and even more favorably, by far, with the Jehovah's Witnesses, who are more clearly world-rejecting as an institution. So when considered next to its two closest competitors, Adventism seems less culty, you know? Have you noticed this? Now, many people, being good-hearted, in a sense, seem quite willing to give Adventists the benefit of the doubt, rather than to view them antagonistically, especially since the church can be evasive and deceptive about what it really believes and what its history really was, and quite skillful in doublespeak and gaslighting uninformed inquirers. Although, this will interest you, in a widely quoted national survey, religion survey last year, among U.S. denominations, the SDA church was viewed unfavorably by the largest number of respondents. It's the YouGov poll, look it up. So, cults. The more formal definitions of the word cult tend to focus on two areas, behavior and beliefs. Now, behavior takes us into the province of psychologists and sociologists. We're not going there tonight. Beliefs, however, take us into the realm of theology, doctrinal orthodoxy, and heresy. How should we understand these words, orthodoxy and heresy? How many of you were here in 2015? Anyone? Anyone? A few of you? Yes? Of course, the Careys were here. The Grangers were here. The Takers were here. Rob Bowman was here. Dr. Robert M. Bowman, Jr., now president of the Institute for Religious Research. I love his book, Orthodoxy and Heresy, and he makes a lot of things wonderfully clear. This is how he defines cult, quote, a religious group originating as a heretical sect and maintaining fervent commitment to heresy. What is his definition of heresy? Quote, a teaching which opposes the essentials of the Christian faith, so that true Christians must divide themselves from those who hold it. Now, if those are our operational definitions of cult and heresy, then Seventh-day Adventism as a theological system is a clear candidate. But again, to repeat, using the word cult to label Adventism can easily alienate both of the audiences we ostensibly want to persuade. So, if we're convinced that Seventh-day Adventism needs to be understood, answered, and opposed, how do we best persuade skeptical Christians of the seriousness of this problem? No, I know I'm coming along here after the tinkers have been knocking themselves out doing that very thing. But give me a chance. I propose that instead of a label that's polarizing, we use a simple description that's clarifying and that sets up a simple, memorable, biblical explanation. Something strong, succinct, sufficient, not sensationalistic, memorable, relatively easy for the average person to explain, easy to support from authoritative Adventist sources, mainly Ellen White herself. Something that anticipates objections and is therefore more difficult for Adventists to simply dismiss or deny. So let me propose a better way of labeling the problem. Seventh-day Adventism is a clever and dangerous spiritual counterfeit. So just think about that. A clever and dangerous spiritual counterfeit. That's accurate, doesn't punch the usual buttons, but stay with me. There's a companion argument that I'd like you to evaluate for me, right? This is a work in progress. So in almost every book, the New Testament warns Christians again and again about false prophets, false Christs, and false gospels. Yes? Yes. Yes, you've seen it, right? You don't need me to proof text that. You know it, you're persuaded. So, Seventh-day Adventism is so dangerous because it comes with all three. A false prophet, a false Jesus, and an impossible salvation. Amen. Now, I think if you share those three points with any concerned Christian or potentially concerned Christian, you will probably have their attention. And they will know in what areas they need to be wary of Seventh-day Adventism. So, a proposed approach. I've got these three points. Each of them has two or three sub-points each. I'll illustrate them with a few examples, and there's a bit of overlap from one point to the next. Number one, Seventh-day Adventism offers us a false prophet. By the way, a 70-year career characterized by error, deception, and confusion. While claiming divine authority, Ellen White, three sub-points, contradicted the Bible in harmful ways. Contradicted the Bible in harmful ways, not trivial ways, harmful ways. Undermining essential doctrines like the Trinity, person and work of Christ, salvation. Second, she added to the Bible in harmful ways. She fictionalized the life of Jesus. She created detailed imaginary events, invented commandments, changed the Bible's meaning again and again. And third, she made false prophecies, something that the Bible specifically makes a test for prophets. That's point number one. Point number two, Seventh-day Adventism offers us a false Jesus. What does it teach about his nature and identity? Well, confusion and mixed messages about the doctrine of the Trinity since day one. Day one. Most SDA founders were Arians who openly rejected Jesus as God. Ellen White described Jesus and Satan as being almost equals until the Father promoted Jesus in a special heavenly ceremony. She wrote that Jesus took upon himself, recite it with me, fallen, suffering human nature, degraded and defiled by sin. And Adventism teaches that Michael the Archangel is, quote, none other than Christ. Thank you, Kaspars, for that wonderful article last week. A false Jesus, not only concerning his nature and identity, but also his work on our behalf. Ellen White claimed that Jesus had to plead with God the Father three times for permission to become the Savior. Jesus' ministry on earth was as our example to show humanity that all Ten Commandments could be kept. Jesus doubted that God the Father would even accept his sacrifice on the cross. Jesus didn't even know whether he would rise from the dead. And by the way, his atonement is incomplete, as we'll see more on this in a moment. Seventh-day Adventism offers us a false Jesus. And third, an impossible salvation. Ellen White stated repeatedly and in various ways that our eternal salvation depends on our personal worthiness. That makes it mission impossible. That includes keeping Ellen's own invented requirements for salvation, like abstaining from drinking tea and coffee. Also, that our salvation is impossible because Jesus' atonement for our sins is incomplete. An imaginary investigative judgment began in 1844, and it's still going on. None of us can know when this process will be finished or who will be saved. And guys, skeptical friends, imagine that you are my skeptical friends, Adventism doesn't exist apart from this investigative judgment. The church vanishes without the investigative judgment. Now, of course, these three major points don't exhaust what is theologically wrong with Adventism, right? They're just the tip of the iceberg. But I believe they are potentially quite sufficient to drive home the point that Adventist teaching is deeply heretical, and yes, here it comes, cultic. Now, why use Ellen White as the launch point of this three-step explanation? Because in actual Adventist practice, the Bible is subordinate to Ellen. In her way, Ellen G. White is just as much a false prophet as Charles Taze Russell and Joseph Smith, even if their errors were not identical. The gravity of their sin is at least equal. Now, for my skeptical friends who might be wondering why this approach is being taken, how authoritative and influential is Adventism's false prophet? Well, according to Ellen herself, she repeatedly and in various ways described her own work and writings as being divinely inspired, basically infallible, and not subject to challenge. And according to Ted Wilson, the current General Conference president of the SDA Church worldwide, entering his 13th year in office, Ellen is both essential and unassailable. I quote from his Sabbath sermon at the October 2021 annual council meetings, quote, "The spirit of prophecy is absolutely reliable and is to be believed and accepted in its entirety. Ellen White was absolutely a prophet of God, and her ministry, including strong messages from the throne room of God about apocalyptic prophecy and instruction, are for all time." Close quote. Now, maybe you've heard about the Great Controversy Project 2.0, right? Last May, Great Controversy was voted by the SDA General Conference Executive Committee as the missionary book of the year, with plans to distribute millions and millions more copies this year and next year in preparation for Jesus' return. This is Ted Wilson describing the Great Controversy. Quote, it was inspired and guided by the Holy Spirit. Quote, I believe every word in this book. Quote, in fact, we're even talking about distributing up to 1 billion copies of this book. That was in 2021. So this is not a peripheral issue. There is no Adventism apart from its false prophet, Ellen G. White, as you know. So, in closing, we can sum up the core of Adventism's error in 3 points, and by doing so, we may be able to more easily warn and equip many Christians who might otherwise might not grasp the urgency of resisting Adventist proselytizing and evangelizing Adventists who are enslaved by error. Bottom line, Seventh-day Adventism is a clever and dangerous spiritual counterfeit. And it's radically wrong about 3 things that the Bible specifically identifies as marks of a dangerous spiritual counterfeit. Let's pray. Merciful, gracious God, we thank you for revealing yourself in your word, for being at work in our world through the Holy Spirit, and for calling us unto yourself. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to share your love with Adventists in gentleness and truth, but also, Lord, to alert our brothers and sisters in Christ that there is a work to be done to show your love, your truth to those who are enslaved by Ellen and her Adventism. Father, give us the means, give us the courage, give us the stamina to do this faithfully in the time that remains. We worship you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Already see, we're going to have a lot in common to share our thoughts on Adventism. But I do want to explain to you first of all, my name's Jim. Those of you, I hopefully, you know, some of you, I think I've seen some of my videos that I've done. But I want to explain to you, how did I wind up here in this space? You know, I remember the first conference I came to. I knew it was going to be funny when I'm coming here, because I know I'm the outside guy. I don't know anybody here. And I walk in the door, and I remember meeting people, and they would come up to me, and they go, how long you been out? And I say, never was in. And then the response usually went something like this, what are you doing here? And I would say something like this. And this is what actually happened. I was literally sitting at my computer desk and wanting to do something more in terms of using my gifts that I've been gifted with for the Lord and reaching the lost. Now, here's where I started. You heard from my bio earlier. 1990 is when I became a Christian, right? Basically, when I left the U.S. Army, I was in the 82nd Airborne in the U.S. Army. So I left the military, became a Christian. Was a Christian for about 6 months. I remember, and I remember at that time I was using my GI Bill and I'm going to school, and I'm literally sitting on my floor doing homework, because that's what you do when you go to school part time. You work all day and you go to school at night. And then I hear this on my door, and I look up, and there's two young, nicely dressed young ladies on my door. Oh, it's Jehovah's Witnesses. I thought, this is great, because they come to me. I don't even have to go to them. And then as soon as I got up and I took a step, then you ever had that panic feeling? You just that cold? Because I started going, you don't even know what you believe. You just don't know anything. And that was true. I didn't. But then I started studying the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. I still occasionally try to go out on the streets and witness to Jehovah's Witnesses. When they're standing in front of libraries and donut shops, they got their magazines. I love to walk up to them and, you know, try to get a conversation. It only goes once. They're getting harder to talk to. They really are over the years, I've noticed. As I was studying my apologetics with Jehovah's Witnesses, I remember one day I was in my library. I'd finished an apologetical book. At this time, I was riding the train to work every day. I love my train, riding the train. I don't do it anymore. But I put on my headset. I could tune out everybody, and I could just read as I'm going to and from work. Remember, I'm in my library, and I just looked up at my Quran on my top shelf, and this I just felt like, you know, you've been ignoring that religion way too long. This was 8 months before September 11th. And I did a deep dive in Islam 8 months before September 11th. And I remember when it happened, I went, I know why it happened. I've been studying the Hadiths, the Quran. I get it. At that time, I go to mosque on Fridays and greet the Muslims when they come out of prayer. And I have Qurans and I got Hadiths with me. And I talk to them and share the real Injil, the real gospel with the Muslims. Well, my work schedule changed and I can't go to the mosque anymore, right, on Fridays. Jehovah's Witnesses won't talk to me. I mean, literally, they see my truck and they run. They won't talk to, I mean, they're really getting harder to talk to. And I remember sitting at my desk going, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And I go online, I go, yeah, YouTube. And I know some of the premier Muslim apologists. I'm still engaged with my Muslim ministry. I mean, I just talked to our leader yesterday. And they're already doing a good job. I was like, why am I going to go there? They're already there. And I know others doing Jehovah's Witness stuff. And I know some of those ministries have been there for a long time. They're already there. I thought, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to do what everyone else is doing. And then I looked around and I go, huh, Adventist. And I started looking around and I go, you know, there are some people here. It's true, there are. But there's not as many. And the material that they have is not as in-depth and as deep as, I mean, you know, my library is, I don't know, roughly probably 5,000 books. And I've got a lot of, I own many, many, many. If you're going to deal with Jehovah's Witnesses, you have to deal with original literature. They don't take photocopies. So I got all their studies in the scriptures, millennial dawns, early golden ages, da, 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 and I deal with them. I love going out on the street, pulling out a magazine from, you know, 1920, saying, let's talk about Beth Serim, you know, which is a false prophecy from 1925. So I said, you know, I'll do an Adventist. And never even met an Adventist, by the way. Don't even know any Adventists. But I did order something that I had. Ordered this a long time ago. Because if you studied the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, you are going to run into a guy named William Miller. Because Charles Taze Russell called William Miller Father Miller in the early Watchtower magazines. I knew all about William Miller and Second Day Adventism and Joshua Himes, and I knew all that stuff, but I didn't know much about Seventh Day Adventism. I knew a little bit, and I got on this guy's mailing list way back in the day. He has since passed away. I think it was Payson, Arizona. Leaves of Autumn Books. You ever heard of Leaves of Autumn Books, some of you? And he used to send out a list you could buy used books from. And I remember I got Spiritual Gifts, Volume 3 and Volume 4, original editions, 1864. In, I think it's Volume 3, is Ellen White's, air quote, famous quote on amalgamation of man and beast. Because here's what I know about false religions and their prophets. Their prophets will say the darndest things, and they'll put it in writing. And I learned this from the Jehovah's Witnesses, collect original material. And that's what I do. That's all I do. I don't quote books from other people. I don't quote other people. If I say this all the time. If I quote it, I own it. I'll show it to you. If I quote it, I own it. And so I had that. And I thought, I got to go to Adventist. And so I sat down on YouTube, started dialoguing Seventh-day Adventist. I didn't even have argument one about the Sabbath, right? The big beast in the room with Seventh-day Adventists. I didn't even know how their arguments. I didn't know nothing. Right? So I'm a blank slate running down this road. Showed up to my first conference. I remember sitting next to Dale Ratzlaff over here. Had lunch with him the first day. And he looked at me too. He goes, well, what are you doing here? I said, well, Dale, this is what I'm doing. He goes, you got to understand the Sabbath. You better get that Sabbath thing down. He goes, because that's where they're going to go all the time. I said, sir, you know, and I got his book and, you know, Sabbath in Crisis. And I started reading his book. So that's what got me on this road. I've been on this road now about 4 years that I've been doing this. I dialogue Seventh-day Adventist. I deal with Seventh-day Adventist every day. About an hour or so a day, every day. Sometimes a little more than an hour, sometimes a little less than an hour. But every day I'm talking to Adventists. I'm in Central America, South America, Africa, Europe, the Middle East. This morning I was telling Debbie, I was posting a comment in Portuguese on a Portuguese channel exposing Seventh-day Adventism. Google Translate's wonderful. I've dialogued Seventh-day Adventists in Spanish, Slovakian, Portuguese, and English. And you know what I find? They're all the same. The Slovakian Seventh-day Adventist gives me all the same proof texts. Well, you know, Jesus said, keep John 14, 15, right? Keep the commandments. And it's like, oh, it's in Slovakian and Spanish. And they all do the same thing. So my topic is, why worry about Seventh-day Adventists? And I agree a lot with what Paul said. First of all, I don't use the word cult when I dialogue Seventh-day Adventists. Well, because I saw early on when others were doing it, they would just screw themselves into the ceiling, run around the room with their hands in the air going, we're not a cult, we're not a cult. And I quickly learned that, yeah, that it's inflammatory. And it's like, you know what? I don't want to talk to you whether you're a cult or not. I'm not interested in that. Here's what I will say, you're not Christian. That's what I'm interested in. And why would I say that? Because you got a different Jesus and you got a different gospel. And that's what I talk about. I bang that single point on my keyboard every day. That's all I want to talk about. Who's your Jesus in Seventh-day Adventism? And your three angels' messages. And I say all the time, and I say, yeah, your three, and then of course when I say that to Seventh-day Adventists, the three angels' messages, go, well, yeah, just go to Revelation 14, 6, it's right there, see, everlasting gospel. And I say, but do you realize that each of your angels has gospel messages? What are those gospel messages of your angels? What's the gospel message of the first angel, the second angel, the third angel? Why don't you show me, can you show me that in the Bible? And then the conversation goes dark because they can't. And I say, well, you know, I can show you where they come from. Here's my two sources. I collect their books. I love collecting their books. All right, this is my working copy of my 28 Beliefs book with all my notes in it. I got another one, a clean one I use for pictures. And I love this one, Discipleship Handbook. And I quote these all. Matter of fact, this book here is just a gem. If you read the preface of this book, this is a GC, General Conference published book. They tell you these GC guys that put this book together said they did this under the direction of the Holy Spirit. It's in the preface. And if you don't believe me, you can talk to me after. I'll show you. I got it underlined. I go, ooh, I got something here that came from God. Yes. Right here. All right. And so when you talk to me about the three angels' messages and what each gospel angel is saying, I put these two together. Because in this 28 Beliefs book, I got the chapter on the remnant. And then on page 196, which I quote it all the time, page 196 to 201, it's the mission of the remnant. Guess what the mission of the remnant is? Preach the three angels' gospel. And then they define what each of the angels say. One of my favorite ones is, speaking of I think it's the third angel. One of the messages is a message about Darwinism. Call an alert to, you know, Darwinism and evolution. I love, I ask the Adventists, I go, oh, so that's one of your gospel messages, Darwin. Can you show me where any apostle taught about Darwinism in the Bible? Right, because then you know where I'm going right after that with the Adventists. I'm going, do you know that if you preach a gospel other than the gospel that the apostle Paul taught and received from the risen Christ, Galatians 1 says you are twice cursed. I said, now this is serious. And that's what I often tell them. You know, we may be having this exchange and going back and forth, and it may seem like linguistic, you know, gymnastics. I go, no, this is serious. You are preaching a message which the Bible says is cursed. I said, you ought to be concerned. I'm concerned enough to show this to you right now. Because I saw Adventists today saying, oh no, we preach the gospel message of Paul. I went, No, you don't. I take them to the, I go, what's the mission of the remnant? Page 196 to 201 in the 28 Beliefs book. Everlasting gospel. And where am I going to find the definition of that? I'm going to find it in the Bible. And I talk a lot about their Jesus. I say, who is your Jesus? By the way, most of the Christian church doesn't even recognize this fact, that there are other Jesuses out there. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. The Apostle Paul is with the Corinthian church, fretting over them, going, I'm afraid if someone comes and preaches a Jesus other than the one that you've been taught, you're going to just put up with it. And I say, oh yeah, there's all kinds of Jesuses out there. I can talk about who the Jesus of the Jehovah's Witness, right, the Mormons, the Christians, and on and on and on. And I say, and who's your Jesus, Seventh-day Adventist? I mean, if I almost say, you know, if I was to pick him up and turn him over, it would say made in 1844. Yeah. Right? Because he was made in 1844. I said, you have a different Jesus. You got a Jesus dressed as a Levitical priest in the temple right now, doing the investigative judgment with sins of people, sins in heaven, and forgiving sins in a second phase of atonement. I say, how is Jesus a Levitical priest? And of course, right, he's of the tribe of Judah. He's not Levi. But I find all the pictures of, you know, Christ, and you've all seen them, you formers, you already know. They got Jesus dressed up with, right, the fancy Levitical garb on. And I say, you got a different Christ. This is serious. These are the two issues I bang on all the time. I want the Adventists to know you got a different Jesus and you got a different gospel. And if you have those things and those two things are different, you're in trouble. Matthew chapter 7, Christ said what? Not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, is going to enter the kingdom of heaven. I mean, if you read that, Matthew 7, 21 through 23, there are people there who clearly think they're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. And I point that out to Adventists all the time. I go, you may think you're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. I said, but if you have a different Christ and you have a different gospel, I said, you're in trouble. I present this message probably near every day, multiple times a day, to Adventists all around the world. And I mean, sometimes I walk away from my keyboard and I go, oh, because I'm worried for them. And I'm distressed because sometimes they'll totally reject what I say. I said, if that's fine, you know, right? We don't force people to believe anything. I'm presenting this to you, though. But they'll reject it. And sometimes I just feel, I go, wow. I go talk to my wife and I go, oh, I just had this conversation with this guy and it went like this. And I presented this and he's just totally, I was like, wow. I go, this is serious business. And they reject it all the time. Now, I love what Greg Kokel says. Sometimes if all your mission is, if you can put a rock in someone's shoe, it's a little irritant. I look at a lot of what I do as doing just that. I am putting rocks in people's shoe. As an irritant. So why worry about Adventists? It is clearly everything, like Paul said, they got a false Jesus and they got a false gospel. But they won't tell you that at first. I've dealt a lot with Adventists. They love to say, well, you know, we believe in Jesus like you believe in Jesus. Right? Sola Scriptura. I just did a video on Sola Scriptura. Probably, I think it's still out there now. I think it's the current one. The January 2023, because I subscribe to the Adventist Review magazine. I love it. I love telling Adventists I subscribe to your literature and send it to me. And I do. I get their magazine, I read your magazine. And when I find something of noteworthy, then I'm going to make a video on it. And I made a video of the January 2023 magazine. Because I opened up their magazine. And as I do all that, I'm looking at it and I go, oh, we got a reading plan. A Bible reading plan for 2023. I go, oh, I start looking at it and I go, and out in the margin, like for January 1st, it just says DA and some pages. Desire of the Ages. I forget what the acronym is again for Christ Object Lessons. But that's out there too. And then they had Bible verse, and then they had Bible day. So just in the first week of January, like three or four of the days were just DA days. And like two or three days were just Bible days. And I thought, nah, I'm gonna sniff this one out. I'm gonna look at this. Here's the grand result. I have Desire of the Ages and Christology Collections in PDF. I dumped those into Microsoft Word. I was able through the use of, you know, wild cards and macros, pull out all words that are not readable words. Chapter headings, page numbers. I just want pure reading text. Because in 2023, at Seventh-day Adventists are going to read Desire of the Ages and Christ's Object Lessons and the Four Gospels. The Four Gospels in the KJV translation are 82,600 words. Desire of the Ages, and hold on to your seats. Desire of the Ages and Christ's Object Lessons are 393,916 words. And I go to my Adventist friends, sola what? Sola Ellen is what I say a lot to them. Sola Ellen. 393,916 Ellen White words you will read as an Adventist if you follow this plan in 2023 in 82,600 words of just the four Gospels. Oh, yeah. It's sola, no, they love to say sola scriptura. Oh, they do. And, you know, some of them are just losing their mind in the comments on this video because I just say, hey, it is what it is. The facts are the facts. And in the video, I hold up the Ellen White books, the Desire of the Age and Christ Object Lessons, and I put the Bible underneath it to show subservient. I said, this is what you're doing. You're placing the words of your prophet above the word of God. And that's what they do in Seventh-day Adventists. I like when you mention cults. Like I said, I stay away from it. Did you know that you're a cult? Adventists love to call all kinds of people cults. First of all, I went to the Adventist archive site and downloaded everything I could absolutely download in PDF. I forget what it is now, something like 7,000 or 8,000 Review and Heralds going back to the 1850s. I downloaded those one at a time. I got them all. Signs of the Times, the Health Reformer, and I downloaded everything I can. Everything. I estimate I got somewhere in the neighborhood 20 plus thousand magazines from their website. Plus I downloaded all the books. And with Adobe Acrobat, I can do searches. And so here's what I also I noted before I'll talk to you about cults. And the problem I see with Seventh-day Adventists is, as I study Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and other groups, there have been great men and women of God who have written books and research on these cult groups. And really your task, if you want to witness to Jehovah's Witness, your hardest task is going to be, how do I wade through all the Christian literature that's been written out there about them so I can find, you know, some good, you know, research that'll get me started. And once you find that, it's really just a matter of simple fact of reading, you know, perhaps this one, two, or three apologetical books going, oh, okay, I see what the problems are. Bible, you're off and running. It doesn't work like that in Adventists. Not at all. You don't have that depth and volume of literature these other groups have. I noticed it right off the bat. One of my favorite books I use in Jehovah's Witness ministry to help me get my feet on the ground and pointing in the right direction was a book by a guy named David Reed called Index to Watchtower Errors. And in that book, it's just all these lists of all these Watchtower, Golden Age, Constellation magazines, and all the silly nonsense things and unbiblical things that they've said, you know, for decades. What a resource. And I thought, I want that in Adventism. I did find a small book by Mark Martin, a little small paperback. But it's like nowhere near the volume of the David Reed book. So I've been making my own Index to Errors. My Microsoft Word file now is in excess of 300 pages. So I do searches all the time in those PDFs that I told you about. One of the searches I did was cults. Cult and cults. I said, show me all instances of those two words in all Adventist magazine. And sometimes it takes me days to go through this stuff. And so you know what I found? You're a cult. Oh, they hate to be called a cult. They call everybody under the sun a cult. And I documented all of that. I mean, whether you're a Baha'i, you're a Christian Science, you're a you know, Jehovah's Witness, et cetera, they call all kinds of people a cult. So I think it's funny because they just literally will lose their mind if you call them a cult. But oh, they'll call you a cult in a minute. But I love it because I say this to Adventists all the time. I go, well, you call evangelical Christians a cult. They say, no, we don't. I go, oh yeah, you do. Yeah. September 9th, 1999, page 10. Review and Herald magazine. Listen to this. So this is the fall of the communists here. And I quote, when the communist regime collapsed in 1991, it left a spiritual vacuum that a variety of eager missionaries and cult followers rushed in. Who rushed in? Cult followers. Let's identify these cults. Hare Krishnas could be seen parading Novitsky Prospect in their monk-like garbs. Jehovah Witnesses crusaded with their literatures, and evangelical Protestants swept through the cities with their soul-winning efforts. There's the cults. Hare Krishnas, Jehovah Witnesses, and evangelical Christians. What I also think was funny, too, by the way, when I did that cult search, and when you were talking, I remember and I wrote it down, I found a quote from 1984, where they were talking, this one Adventist scholar says, please don't ever produce our own Bible. The minute we produce our own Bible, people are going to call us a cult. 1984. What'd they do 10 years after that? The Clear Word Bible. So sometimes I'll use that in my comments on Adventists. I say, y'all just called yourself a cult. I'll give the quote from the scholar from 1984, and then I'll say, here's Jack Blanco's work in 1994. You know, you call yourself a cult. Another quote I would like, speaking of Ellen White, and this is a quote that I found fairly recently. One of the biggest things, I think, in Adventism is the atonement of Christ. It's huge. I quote this book all the time. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 357. I can almost quote you what Ellen White says on that page because I use the quote all the time. Christ did not die on the cross to cancel out sin. Sin would be dealt with in the sanctuary. All right. And I find that same kind of quote in Adventist literature over and over and over. Christ didn't die on the cross. I mean, to me, that's case number one. When I talk to an Adventist, by the way, Adventists love to call me brother. All the time in the comments. Hey, brother, don't be so harsh on us or don't say these bad things. I never let that comment go, ever. I say, sorry, we are not brothers in Christ. We are brothers in Adam, but we are not brothers in Christ. The reason why that we are not brothers in Christ is because if you are a 28 belief-believing Adventist, and you've been baptized, here's the current church manual, which is, as I understand, is going to be changing soon, because I read the conference reports, is going to be changing. The church manual here, on page 46, I think I got tabbed, so 13 baptismal vows. You've taken a vow to Ellen White. I think it's vow number 8. And I said, and in this book, not only does Ellen White have her own chapter, Spirit of Prophecy, but chapter 24, the investigative judgment, the sanctuary. And what does it say in the upper part of the paragraph? That Christ is engaging in his second phase of atonement. Where does the Bible talk about a multi-phase atonement? It doesn't. I share this with Adventists all the time. Now I don't know what's going on in Adventism. Maybe it's ignorance of what the Adventism teaches, but I find that doctrine right there, because I ask Adventists all the time, did Jesus die on the cross for your sins? And probably 90% of the Adventists will say, oh yeah, absolutely. I go, uh-uh. Sorry. According to your prophet. And then I'll send him that Ellen White quote, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 357. And guess what the Adventist does? He falls backwards and says, whoa, let me go to your church and get baptized, right? Yeah. You know what they do? And I've seen this with Jehovah's Witnesses on other issues. They do the same thing. They start defending Ellen White. I say, whoa, wait a minute. You just told me You didn't, this is what you believe, and you didn't know this existed, and now I give you the quote, and all of a sudden you act like you know and it exists, and you start defending Ellen White. That's why we need to worry about Seventh-day Adventists. Even these liberal that we often talk about, Seventh-day Adventists, who maybe don't have these very staunch beliefs that some of these conservative Adventists have, when they're, I see this thing happen all the time. I'll present them with an actual belief from Ellen White that they said, well, I don't know nothing about that. And then I show it to them, they go, oh yeah, and then they start defending it. Every single time they do that. It's disturbing to a certain degree. All right, I'm gonna see if I can find one last quote here. If not, then we'll finish this up. It's about that time. Oh yeah, by the way, I get called a Jesuit at least once a week. I love telling the Adventists, I say, oh yeah, yeah, I got my Jesuit robe hanging up behind me. It's just funny, it's like that's like the ultimate insult that they do. Anyway, let's see here. All right, I'll just end here on this one last note. Something Adventists do, I think, to downplay Ellen White. They say, oh, don't get all spun up about Ellen White. She's just the lesser light pointing to the greater light. That's all. She's just pointing to the Bible. That's all she does. Well, first of all, anyone you probably already know, in my index that I have, what I call Index of Adventist Errors, you know, I've got probably dozens of quotes where she contradicts the Bible. But I want you guys to know this. That quote is actually, it's an insult to the God of the universe. An absolute insult. Because Ellen, in that quote, and I'm going to read the quote to you, in that quote, becomes the appointed hero of God. Because God can't get anybody to read his word. So he comes to Ellen and says, oh, Ellen, be my lesser light so you can point to the greater light. And you know what the greater light is? It's in her books. That's what the quote actually says. The quote is from January 20th, 1903, on page 15, the Review and Herald magazine. January 20th, 1903, page 15. I'm going to read you the pertinent part of this quote. So when Adventists do this and try to downplay Ellen, I'm like, no, the effect is really something much opposite of that. It's really an elevation of her. And this is what it said. The Lord has sent his people much instruction, line upon line, precept upon precept. Here a little, there a little. Little heed is given to the Bible. And the Lord has given a lesser light to lead men and women to a greater light. Little heed is paid attention to the Bible. So what's the Lord do? He comes to Ellen and says, Ellen, be my lesser light to point to the greater light. And then she goes on to say this, oh, how much good would be accomplished if the books, and by the way, if you read the whole quote, it's the big books, Patriarchs and Prophets, Great Controversy. If the books containing this light were read with a determination to carry out the principles they contain. So whenever I hear Adventists quote this lesser light, like, oh, you know, Ellen White, that's all she does. I go, no, no, you got to read the quote. You got to read the quote. She makes herself out to be the hero to rescue God because no one is paying attention to his word. Absolute insult. That's why I say it's an absolute insult to the true God of the universe. So anyway, I'm going to end right here. I think we're going to get set up for our panel. So thank you very much.